So, here we go. Okay. Awesome. So, welcome again to North Burial Grounds, North NBG Presents. I'm Annalisa Heffner. I'm the director of North Burial Ground, and I'm so excited to have Jay here with us, and I'm just going to let her go ahead and get started.
Awesome. Thank you so much. All right, we'll get started here. Good evening, everybody. Thank you all for being here. I have a story to tell you, and for the very first time. So with that said, we're going to get started. From Within Forbidden Space, a photography journey by myself, Jay Davani. I was born in a culture where we couldn't talk about death, and my only experience with cemeteries was a heavy space filled with profound grief. Then for a significant part of my life, I lived in a place where cemeteries were hidden from the public. Visiting the dead became a forbidden, forgotten, and feared space. It wasn't until later in life that I was pushed through that wall of discomfort through photography. In this talk, I'll take you through my journey as a photographer and how the view from within a forbidden space brought my work back to life. Just a note that all of the images in this presentation are all taken by me and my father. In 1979, there was a revolution in the Middle Eastern country of Iran. There was an overthrow of the current dynasty by an Islamic Republic. The next two images were taken by my father on film, illegally. Fundamentalists took over control. There were riots, and Iranian citizens were incredibly afraid. Restrictions were enforced, including wearing hijabs being required for women. Undercover morality police enforced Iran's Islamic code of conduct in public. Life as everyone knew it completely changed. I was born in the middle of the night, in the middle of a blackout, in Tehran, the capital of Iran, in 1980. My mother went into labor and drove herself to the hospital while on lockdown. She was stopped by revolutionary police countless times along the way. She gave birth to me by herself in the basement of a hospital with only a few staff, nearly in the dark due to the blackout. My mom and I fled Iran together in November of 1983. We immigrated to the US and landed in JFK with one suitcase that apparently they lost. My mom says I slept most of the way with jewels and family heirlooms sewn into the lining of my clothes. I had a little tiny dress on, but it was worth a lot. We flew to Portland, Oregon, and then stayed in Chicago, Illinois with some family from my dad's side. Finally, we made our home in Lexington, Kentucky. I know, shocking. In 1986, this is where my father had gone to a very small liberal arts college to study math before the revolution. It was the only community he really knew. It took me a long time to understand this choice because, you know, the South is one of the worst places you can grow up as an immigrant. In Kentucky, cemeteries were rarely seen. They were just out of sight, walled up, away from main areas. And when you drove by ones that could be seen, they were hidden by large trees, stone walls, or gates, blocking them off from sight. My first funeral was a classmate who had died suddenly in his sleep. And I was one of the very few classmates that felt comfortable enough to go to the funeral home. I'll never forget how his face didn't look like his face, but it was his face. I wasn't prepared to see that. I didn't want to remember him like that. And in that moment, I knew that I didn't want to be embalmed ever, even though I didn't even know what embalming was. The next two photos were taken by my father as we explored the state. No one I knew talked about death in Kentucky. Even when my close friend's mom died of cancer, or when my other classmate killed two people while drinking and driving in his own car, the only time I talked about death with anyone was with a friend in middle school. She sat me down and showed me the final book of Revelations in the Bible. And she told me what would happen to me when I died. She told me I would burn in hell. Thank you, Sarah. I think you might have been wrong about that. It all happened behind closed doors and behind large stone walls covered in vines or surrounded by trees. You knew cemeteries were there because of their vast size, but you couldn't really see them. Histories almost vanish along with these forgotten southern cemeteries and the bodies that went inside them. When my mom married my dad, he was already a photographer. He worked for the Kodak Film Factory in graphic design and marketing. While he worked at Kodak, he learned how to take photos and bought his own camera. Unfortunately, they closed down the company because of the revolution. He lost his job, but he started taking pictures of the Ayatollah and the revolution, and he would sell them illegally. He was documenting history. He continued to document the family when we immigrated to the US, but did not work as a photographer professionally. My father was an amazing film photographer. He shot on a Canon AE-1 film camera just like this one that a friend gave me a few years later. He was always taking pictures of me, my mom, my siblings, and flowers. He loved taking macro shots of flowers. The people that he loved were his subjects. You see, this is how my father showed love. Something I didn't understand as a child. I grew up living in front of my father's camera my entire childhood, but we rarely spoke unless I did something wrong. An unspoken and silent understanding started between us. This was my first cat, Shangul, which means happy in Farsi. She was so cute. There aren't many photos of him and I because he was always the one behind the camera, like here where he was watching me feed these ducks, perfectly framed with an impeccable composition. This is really hard to do on film. This was Persian New Year, and my expression explains our relationship. And that was our first dog, Sasha. But there's something very haunting about the images that he took. This one is one of my favorites, but it also haunts me the most. This is me with perfect hair, held up with perfect little ribbons and perfect pierced ears, in my perfect white college shirt, wearing my perfect corduroy overalls, with my perfect doll with the perfect hair made of yarn, wearing it perfectly, matching overalls, in a perfect rocking chair, both with perfect posture. But look closely. There is another story here. My tiny hands aren't even holding that doll that hasn't been played with. My braids are tight and my expression is expressionless, with eyes that are older than my body. I was 3 years old. It's extremely painful for me to look at most of the images of myself as a child. I never actually looked like a child. I never really look happy. I never really feel like I'm looking at myself. But photographs can capture the truth if you look closely, and I promise you, there is nothing perfect about being perfect. The first time I stood in a cemetery, it was both an extremely sunny and really dark day. My father's father died suddenly and mysteriously. We were not at the funeral. We had missed it somehow. The grass was not disturbed. We had missed it a long time ago, actually. I was 9 years old in Chicago, Illinois, August of 1997. They don't usually take kids to the cemetery, but there was no one there to watch me that day, so I came too. They brought me there and forgot about me amongst the sea of despair. I think this photo is from that day. The next images are of my own from later on in life as I tell you the rest of the story. A namaz was read. That's a specific prayer for the person who's dead. A small group of people stood over my father as he knelt toward the ground. And I remember his body being turned toward the earth as if he wanted to bring himself closer to whatever was buried there. He wept so loudly that it shook me to my core. I can still hear the sound of him crying. It was confusing to watch my father weep for the very first time. I felt both invisible and in the way. I didn't know what was happening. I didn't know what death was. I'd never seen my father cry. I didn't know who these people were, and I didn't know where we were, why we were there. I didn't know what was going on. But it was the first time I recognized suffering. I tried to hide, but there were like only markers on the ground close by. The air was hot and the sun was burning us all. I sat and watched in silence while everyone else was quiet except for my father. These are not photos of that day, although my mother tells me we have them. I didn't ask her to find the rest. I don't want to bring that day back to life for anyone. Persians don't talk about death or the dead. Many of us now refer to Persians as Iranians, most of them who practice Islam. Persian traditions are full of superstitions and customs. It's not respectful to speak about anyone that is dying or someone who is dead. Persians say that if you spend time with someone who is dying, you are actually valued by God. A Persian funeral is extremely important, as in any culture, rich in tradition and has a very, very strict schedule. Iran is mainly a Muslim country with 99.4, to be exact, of the population identifying as Muslim. That means most Persian funerals are technically Muslim funerals, with an order of service, traditions, and music, food to match. Before the funeral itself, someone from the family and mosque will wash the deceased body with water and soap. They'll remove any polish or makeup. Then they will place the hands of the dead in a prayer position and wrap the entire body in a white burial cloth. The person responsible for washing the body is traditionally a family member of the same gender as the deceased. I had the honor of doing this for my aunt. Because we're born into the world naked, Iranian Muslims believe that it's appropriate that we should be essentially naked when we leave the world as well. Makes sense, right? With only a white cloth symbolizing importance covering our bodies. Then they're buried directly into the ground, typically by men, children, or pregnant women allowed.
Yeah, but.
With no casket or biodegradable wooden casket when that's required. The mourning customs of Iranians are usually as formalized as the funeral customs. A public viewing of the deceased body is not customary in Persian culture. This is particularly due to the fact that most Persians emphasize the importance of burying someone's body as soon as possible after their death. The schedule for a traditional Iranian or Persian funeral tends to be fairly rigid. Muslim Iranians try to bury a person's body within 24 hours of their death, if possible. There's no embalming. Every religion has their rules. On the third day after the burial, everyone goes back to the cemetery to bring offerings. On the seventh day, they have a ceremony and prayers at the mosque to promote crying. It's like a weeping ceremony, my mom said, for relief of the sadness, to get it all out. The traditional mourning period is 40 days, but it can last anywhere to a year. The immediate family wears black every single day for up to 40 days. And on the 40th day, they go back to the grave to give offerings. Widows or widowers may wear black for an entire year or longer. But with all these rituals, it's an unspoken rule that it's forbidden to speak about death prior to the death. Persians are very superstitious people. We hang the evil eye above our door. We burn esfand constantly. That's like sage. You don't talk about the end of life plans. You don't mention if someone else is dying. And you don't wear black when you're not in mourning. You definitely don't talk about your own death. Suicide is a sin, and you don't take what's been given to you unless it's your time. But I have always been curious about death and the afterlife. And those of you who know me know I only wear black. I even toured a morgue in Canada once. Many people fear dying, and the fear of death and dying runs in my family and many families. But it is perpetuated culturally. There are too many stories to tell about why this gets reinforced, but some planted seeds of terror more than others. My father had a friend die unexpectedly when he and my mother were newlyweds in Iran. He saw her face in the ground once they put her in the grave. It's customary to uncover the face right before adding dirt to let the soul be free. This really traumatized him. This made cemeteries trigger trauma moving forward. My mother was pregnant with me at that time, and my father, her father actually wouldn't let her go to the funeral. Persians believe that the soul of the child is clean when you're in the womb, and you don't need to expose them to another soul that's leaving. They believe the soul separates from the body and the child is actually at risk. My aunt would say that she would come home when she would go near a cemetery and she would take off her shoes and take a shower because she thought that there were viruses very close to the cemetery. The fear of death is generational. It's like a baton tossed down to their children year after year after year. I've only encountered death a few times in my lifetime, and I've only been to one funeral in an actual cemetery. My experiences have had significant impact on me in a way that allows me to see the world differently. There have been a few key moments where my path has crossed with cemeteries that have been tremendous and have impacted me in a different way. The following images are not related to the stories I'm going to tell you, but I've been taking a series to document the final days that I'm spending with a dear friend of mine who is actually near the end of her life. In 2013, my grandmother suddenly died in her sleep. My mother had vowed to take her body back to Iran. What a feat. We didn't talk about it at the time, and she did it all alone. But my mother tells me now that the process was an arduous one, but it was a promise and it had to be kept. Can you imagine the final like resting place of someone is so important? My mother had to send in a death certificate to the embassy to get permission to even take the body back to Iran. Then they approved it, but then they just dictated a very specific way the body had to be processed, which goes against all of the Muslim traditions. It had to be a wooden casket inside of a metal box, and the body had to be embalmed. My mother took the long flight alone with her mother in cargo, and in the cemetery came to get the body at the airport to take it to the burial. My mother had the hard task of IDing the body after 1 month of transport. In Iran, they rewashed the body and they removed all the embalming to bring the body back to purity again. She was buried in the Behesht-e Zahra, which is the heaven of Zahra, the same place my grandfather and uncle are also buried. Around 2015, my aunt died from cancer. We barely talked about it as a family internally, even though it was right in front of us. I was involved in every step of the process, helping my cousin, from deciding to take her off support, to picking out a plot, to cleaning out the estate. I was honored to partake in her washing ceremony on behalf of my cousin. It was the single most beautiful thing I have ever done for anyone ever in my entire life. A sense of peace filled me in a way that I had never known. I was not afraid, and I knew that that had to be rare. But the experience inside the cemetery was one I didn't expect. It felt like a used car lot. We rode in a golf cart with a binder full of photos and clear sleeves with photos of the plots. I couldn't believe this was how it was done. I couldn't believe how much it cost. I couldn't believe how commercial it all felt. Do we want to be underneath a tree or over by this pond? It was such a rare and weird experience for me. Each one of these experiences changed me and transformed how I see the world. I notice things that others don't or can't see. I try to capture images that are both evoking beauty and sorrow simultaneously, because you can't fully understand one without the other. Anila Agh explained this perfectly. This is her exhibit at the Peabody Essex Museum in Salem. It's what happens when someone close to you dies who's been in great pain, or when you see a beautiful sunset but suddenly feel very small. Those are the moments I found particularly poignant and I strive for in my art. I started shooting film in 2003 in Atlanta. I went to a college named Emory in Georgia, and I picked up a film camera for the first time for my job. I taught myself how to use it, and I also taught myself graphic design. That's right, on Quark. Both came pretty easily to me, maybe because both have always been second nature to me because of my dad. My father always carried a camera around, and one day it was in my hand too. I always resisted taking on his hobby because of my strained relationship with him. We had a difficult relationship. We did not understand each other, and we barely spoke. He never showed me how to use the camera, and I regret never asking him. But somehow the camera found me. To the left is a rare test shot of me taken by a bride on her wedding day on my film camera. I always had two cameras, one with color film and the other with black and white film. This was before, you know, digital cameras. To the right is the oldest film and most precious Polaroid camera that I own. I paid a whole $5 for it at a flea market, and it was from the late 1800s. It came with a tripod, 50 filter lenses, a flash, a meter, and a leather camera bag that even holds the tripod. Super crazy rare find. I have a pretty big vintage camera collection, and I sell them too. I shot weddings and events for friends reluctantly for that year, but entertained myself by capturing the things you weren't supposed to see. This shot was on film. But I was shocked when the photos came back. Did I really take these? They're actually kind of good. I was always looking where no one else was, at your feet, at your hands. If you follow me on Instagram, then you know my stories are always looking up or looking down, things that most people rarely do. I was able to make time stand still. It was like magic, but it was dark magic to me. And I wasn't sure if I wanted to live in my father's shadow. After I moved to Rhode Island, I missed designing and I decided to get more training. Luckily, I worked at Brown and they paid for me to go to RISD. I was in an extensive 3-year graphic design program through continuing education, and we had to take electives for the program. In the summer of 2007, I took my first photography class, like ever. Digital photography one. The thinking was that the digital camera wasn't the same as the film camera, like my dad, right? Different concept. This could be mine. I bought my first used digital SLR Canon Rebel T3, pictured here, with the help of one of the best photographers I knew here in Rhode Island. This is a self-portrait that I actually took in the bathroom mirror at RISD. The vintage camera strap there came with the camera, and they said it was from the original owner. Our major assignment for the class was to shoot something that makes you uncomfortable. When I moved to New England, seeing cemeteries everywhere was pretty jarring and triggering experience for me. I didn't understand how people walked in them and with their dogs. What are you, jogging? Like, that was so strange to me. Why was the sacred space being treated this way? And why were they everywhere? Why can we see them? And why is everyone seemingly not fazed about being surrounded by death? I understood the assignment. I decided to shoot something that made me incredibly uncomfortable, and that subject would be cemeteries. I selected one of the most beautiful ones I had seen from the road in Portsmouth, New Hampshire, because you know why? No one would see me inside there. The following images were the final selects for this project. I've never shown these photos to anyone except for that one professor. I knew going inside these forbidden spaces was a barrier I needed to cross. It wasn't pleasant at first. Honestly, I felt anxious. I wasn't sure where to step. I felt like I was trespassing, being disrespectful. Could I touch anything? But the details, the silence, the old statues, the markings, the prayers and tokens left behind really caught my attention. I saw beauty everywhere, and I quickly realized that I was inside of a space that actually felt like home. I also identified with something else from within myself. I saw myself there inside the silent statues. My experience with tremendous suffering connected to this space internally. I realized that this was a place I didn't have to fear anymore because it was part of me already. I've been walking inside and shooting cemeteries ever since. Recently, I've been sitting with the idea of how it's a gift to be able to sit with this suffering, how I'm able to see the things that others can't see because I stop when others don't. I have realized that this might be my calling in my work and creatively and most literally with the dying. A huge part of my photography practice is bringing attention to what others can't see. Since I was trained on film, I still maintain that conservative and intentional approach to shooting. I don't take a lot of pictures, but when I do, they are framed meticulously, like my dad. I think about where I am, I spend time with my subject, and I take my time. I am drawn to capture moments that are painfully beautiful and where symmetrical order exists inside disorder. I'm often armed with a tripod and a timer. I get this question a lot. Who took that photo? I am often my own subject. Apple Watch, pretty cool. More importantly, I'm a storyteller. I invite my audience to consider life's most profound questions and moments. Like, what if these two people could never really reach each other? Where were they? And what were they sorry for? How many times have they tried? Through my images and captions, I try to express an idea that's been on my mind. This one read, "Gratitude for solitude. I wish I had found you sooner. I would have loved you longer. I took this with a timer and a tripod alone in the woods." Whether it's a shadow or a fleeting moment beside the sea, I am always looking where no one else is looking. I see what other people miss, like this janitor cleaning out a window display in the mall, perfectly framed inside the clouds. This moment lasted only a moment. Looking up and looking down, or looking up and down at the same time, like seeing clouds in a reflection of a puddle at my feet. This is a self-portrait that I took sitting inside of an airplane window seat in 2016 after a breakup. I felt strong and lost, and I wanted to remember that I could be both at once. The light and the darkness can coexist. My photography is an expression of who I am and what has happened to me, what I'm feeling, what I've heard, where I've been. And I've been all over the world and seen a lot of people and seen a lot of places and a lot of faces. The faces of the sadhus in Nepal will forever haunt me. They are known to be the link between the living and the dead. We actually stood here in silence for quite a while, and I felt like there was an understanding between us. The ashes of the dead color their faces, and they sit by the river where the bodies are burned. My images also are about how I think and what I need you to see. Since I started shooting on black and white film originally, a few years ago, I returned my digital practice to black and white format to focus on composition. My entire Instagram feed is strictly black and white. I'm often asked why, and I'm always having the same answer, why not? Trigger warning for the next two slides. Yeah, I do shoot in color. Commercially, I shoot lifestyle headshots, travel, and events. These are a few of the most recent headshots for different professionals and athletes that I've taken. I do take these photos, you just never see them because they're for the people that pay me to take them. In 2015, I founded a photography collaborative, the first one in Providence ever, which is pretty amazing, to bring together photographers and videographers to feature, collaborate, practice, and learn from each other. We also host an online forum for questions, knowledge share, photography critique, and equipment sales. Over the years, we have hosted bi-monthly meetups, featured photographers every single day, and hosted online trainings for 250 members with the help of 7 moderators. You can find us at PVD Street on Instagram or Facebook. Memento Mori. This is Latin for remember that you have to die. I believe the day that you're born and the day that you die are the most important days of your life. I discovered through some really tough self-work recently that I have a gift to be able to sit with this and the suffering of myself, of others, and for others. I realize that everything I care about, capture, and spend time on relates to this single thread. These forbidden and hidden spaces are fascinating for many reasons, but they are places of tremendous suffering. Walking through graveyards gives me peace, though. The stillness, the history, the sculptures, the souls. So many souls. Someone once told me that they never felt solace visiting my loved ones there. They'd rather visit a place they went together to reflect on them. And perhaps that's the difference between being forced to visit graves and wanting to walk in an unknown cemetery. There is less suffering. My mom said to me recently that humans are so afraid of dying that they're afraid to step inside cemeteries. These spaces are not places to be feared. I would ask anyone who's afraid, if you're not afraid of where you came from before you were born, then why are you afraid of where you go after you die? The more I walk on my own path toward purpose, the more these doors just keep opening. I recently was telling a friend about my journey, thank you so much, and she connected me to the North Burial Ground Instagram. A cemetery with an Instagram account? Are you kidding? Amazing. After a tour with the new cemetery director here with us today, Annalisa, who is bringing the cemetery back to life and who is just amazing, and after attending a beautiful Dia de los Muertos ceremony, here I am speaking to you all about something I've never spoken about before because I have never been actually asked. No one in my life has ever bothered to ask me why until now. North Burial Ground is unlike any other cemetery. You won't get kicked out for taking photos. They actually want you there. And as the alchemist says, when you want something, all the universe conspires to help you achieve it. I read something recently that really solidified my practice and the journey that I've begun. Do the work that comes straight from the soul of you, from your background, from stories that you've grown up with, from the stories you not only yearn to tell, but the ones that if you don't tell them, they won't get told. The key to fulfillment, success, happiness in life is when you align your personality with what your soul actually came here to do. So if you do the work that comes from the interior of your soul and make art from that comes from the interior of you, you cannot miss. It's only when you're doing stuff that you might think might make you some money, you think it'll bring you some level of attention or success, that isn't what does it. It's not for the likes. I don't even look at them anymore. Everything that brought me to this moment virtually in front of all of you has come from working from the interior of myself. And so that's why my work might feel so authentic and you might relate to it because it actually is. From within the forbidden space. You can find me anywhere at the J. Davani, like everywhere. Very consistent with branding. And my next show of work will be May 26th at the Cortland Club Speakeasy in Providence. Good luck finding it. Thank you all for coming, but especially to the North Burial Ground for being the first to ask. If you haven't yet, you should follow them 100%. Their Instagram is awesome and they have amazing programming coming up and more events in the future. And I think we have time for some questions.
Jay, thank you so much.
You're so welcome.
It was fantastic and really beautiful. And I really loved getting to know you this way a little bit more and seeing your work, which is just, I mean, phenomenal. And
thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing. And I'm so glad that like North Burial Ground has been a place for you to come to. And I'm literally speechless, which is hard for me.
I love it. Yes.
Yeah, we have time for questions. I'm going to, I've got you spotlighted, so I'm going to unspotlight you so we can see, so we can see when people are raising their hands.
Hi, everybody. I couldn't see you before. So nice to see all your faces.
You guys, I'm still learning. Okay, there we go. Stop spotlighting. There we go. I'm still learning Teams too. So you all aren't the only ones that have a hard time with this as guests. I know that Teams can be really challenging. So thank you all for putting up with it. Okay, so it looked like there were some questions in the chat. Show conversation. And like I said, use the raise hand function if you have a question as well. It's if you're in the app, it's next to the little smiley face guy. He's kind of like making this face. And if you're using it as a guest, it should be down. You should have like a bar in front of your face that's got one. Oh, here we go. I see Rebecca Weaver. You've got your hand up. I'm going to go ahead. Don't forget to unmute yourself too.
Yes. Hi.
Hi.
Thank you. Great presentation. I loved it so much. I was wondering though, when you do you switch back and forth between film and digital, or do you have a favorite now?
I mostly shoot digital now, even though I have about 14 film cameras. I shoot with my iPhone like a lot because it's with me quite most of the time, and I just upgraded my DSLR to something that I cannot use because I don't understand. No, I can use it, but it's like really complicated and it has video. But I, like most people during COVID, got really burnt out creatively and was only taking pictures digitally and only when asked to take them professionally. I'm excited to start learning my camera more, but I did recently ask my mom for my dad's film camera. She's gonna try to sneak it to me. So I feel like that would feel really amazing to shoot with that. Even though I have a similar camera, it's a different model. And I think it needs to be repaired. So I think that'll inspire me. Film is really expensive, guys. It's really hard to find, and the processing, and but it is magical, and I definitely think I'll revisit, but I'll probably stick to black and white because I'm not processing both. So good to see you. That's an Emery friend. Hey.
Thanks.
Thank you, Rebecca. I see a question in the chat as well. Should I read that one?
Yeah, absolutely. Go for it.
Okay. From my friend Ruth, or she can read it if she's here.
I'll read it. Hi. My question for you is, how does your family feel now about you exploring death so much and wearing black and going to cemeteries? Do they still sort of follow a more traditional approach with that?
Great question. Well, my parents aren't here, so I can tell you the truth. I'm sending them the recording. I was like, my mom can't get on Teams. Okay. It's been like an easement of getting them used to me talking about this more. And one thing I realized is that I had also built up such a fear of talking about death and dying with my parents that I assumed that a lot of times they didn't want to talk about it. And so through this project, actually, of doing this presentation, I talked to my mom a lot. And she told me so many amazing stories. I talked to my brother quite a lot about this process. He's a therapist, so he understands. And I think I have not spoken to my father about it. I think that would be like a more delicate thing that I need to approach maybe in person. But there's still like some eggshells to walk on. My parents have never understood why I wear black. In fact, my mom bought me like a red scarf a few years ago for Christmas. It's a thing that still really rubs her the wrong way. She'll always be like, since when do you wear black? And I'm like, it's been like 6 years, mom. So it's sort of like a challenging topic that comes up sometimes, but I think through this process and also just asking more questions of my family, and especially my parents are getting older, so we're starting to talk about end of life stuff as well, that it's opening up those doors. And I'm approaching it with more of an inquisitive nature, and I think that I'm getting like really good response, even though they're challenging subjects for my parents to talk about, both because of their experience, but because they're both in their, they're getting old. And so facing their own mortality is something that they're starting to think about, and that's really hard. But my siblings and I think, are really trying to present this as like, we want to take care of you and know what your wishes are. So we're through my work and sort of triggering all of these things, we're having really important, real conversations that have been really hard for us. And I'm really happy about that, even though they're really difficult. So I'm glad to be that conduit. And I'm really lucky to have siblings that are also really good and civil-minded about that kind of stuff too. So hopefully that answered your question, Ruth. Anyone else? No other questions? You guys? Did I answer all of your questions? I talked a lot.
No, you talked the right amount. It was amazing. I just wanted to, I actually had a question. Yeah. Have you seen, since you've been spending more time in cemeteries and exploring those places, kind of a shift in your... and I, full disclosure, I'm not a photographer or an artist, so I don't know a lot of the correct terms, but like, have you seen a shift in how you look and identify the compositions that you want to make? I really noticed in the picture that you had of the hands, how much that reminded me of the headstones that we have around here that are joined hands or nearly joined hands.
Yeah.
And you know, I'm sure there's not a one-to-one correlation, but I was really curious if you'd seen kind of a change in how you look at things.
That's a really great question. I think one of the things that I've, as an artist, have also noticed in cemeteries, how much art actually exists in the sculptures and in the stones, the headstones, and in the engravings. And all of that comes from humans, human experience, right? So like, me being with my friend, the most innocent thing that we have together is holding each other's hands right now. And that is an experience that many, many people have had. This is the last contact that you have with someone. And for that to show up in the last remembrance of someone makes sense. So I think they do inform each other. I like to stop and read the stones as well. They're so beautiful, like the things that people write about their loved ones, or the older stones where you get to actually learn about people and who they were. I do think that the two things inform each other. I think more so now I'm looking, in the beginning it was like a macro study. I focused on like small portions of the cemetery because I was so overwhelmed. And now I see the cemetery as a whole, and I'm not afraid to take pictures of other people or myself within that space. Because it's more normalized for me. Those pictures you saw from my class, they were like up close because I was like terrified. I was terrified that someone would see me and that I was going to get kicked out. I've gotten kicked out of Swan Point, by the way, like too many times. Don't be taking pictures in there. That guy is not nice. but yeah, so it's, I think I've pulled back, and I continue to sort of develop like ideas around like how we're remembered and how we're living today.
Awesome. Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. Maria, I see your hand is up.
Yes. Hi, Jay.
Hi.
Great talk. I really enjoyed learning more about your process and seeing more of your photography. You know, mm-hmm. I'm a big fan. I was just wondering if you have a favorite cemetery to shoot in. I know that might sound kind of morbid, but I was wondering if you actually had a favorite.
If you don't say North Burial Ground, that's all right.
After North Burial Ground.
Okay, so after North Burial Ground, which is the best and the only one with an Instagram account, if I didn't mention that already, this year I actually found the oldest cemetery in Rhode Island. Did you know that it was in Riverside? I went there on Halloween, ironically, I know, but I didn't have any Halloween plans, which is shocking for me. But I found it and I went there and it is beautiful. If you guys remember, I don't know if you remember that one shot that I showed that was like the gate with the face. It was like a metal gate with like a really stark face. So the cemetery is not that big, but it's by a body of water, which is just beautiful. And the stones are really old. There's a lot of metal work there too, which is not really common. And another thing that I really loved about that cemetery and why I think it's one of my favorites right now is that there's a lot of types of art that I've never seen on stones before, like reverse, almost like graphic design imprinting on stonework. And they're from like the 1800s, like it's wild, some of them 1700s. So I highly recommend that cemetery. It's really easy to get to, it's pretty small. There's no attendant or anything like that. And it's actually quite serene. It's right by the water. And there's a lot of like metal plaques and stuff too with historical references. So I'd say that one's like top of the list right now. Yeah. Good question, Maria.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Oh, go ahead.
Nope.
Oh, I should say there are two great questions in the chat if you want to. I wasn't sure if you could see it.
No, I haven't read these, and I hope I can like save this so I can read it later because there's so many.
We'll send you the chat for sure. Okay. You're getting a ton of wonderful compliments too. You all are a lovely audience because obviously it is great. So this is wonderful. Okay, so Kelly asks, how do you approach expressing big life emotions via art photography? Is your process mostly emotionally driven? Your self-portrait seemed to capture emotion beautifully.
Thanks. I think that I just try to be authentic, and that's been a really hard thing with social media. I changed my practice probably like 3 years ago. You can see on my Instagram feed, if you like go down deep into the gram, you can see where a shift happened. And a shift happened in me, in my personal life. That caused that shift, and I stopped giving a shit. I'm just gonna tell you that. Like, I stopped caring, like, what everybody thought, and I stopped looking at my likes, and I stopped looking really at, like, bot comments, and I just stopped caring. And part of that, I think, has made my work more authentic because I don't care. I don't care if you like it or not. I don't care if there's gonna be, like, new followers. And usually, I'm matching up a moment with something that's really authentically happening to me. So if you read my captions, which I spend a lot of time on, you're going to learn a lot about me and about life and a lot about the things that I'm thinking about. I've become more vulnerable in that way because I stopped caring about what other people thought of me or what kind of like image I was supposed to project into the world for other people to see and like me. I used to go out in public and people would be like, oh my God, are you the Jay Davani? And I was like, what does that mean? Who do you think I am? And I realized that all these people think they know who I am because they follow me on Instagram. You don't know me. Most people don't know me. Most of my closest friends don't know me. And so I felt like if I was going to partake, which my brother, if he's here, will like kibosh this in social media, that I was going to present as my truest self. So I think that I just do what I want when I want. And sometimes a little voice comes in my head and it's like, if you get a job in the future, like, what if they read this? Like, what are they going to think? And then I'm like, no. This is who I am, and I'm not saying anything that I'm not proud of. Like, being human shouldn't be something that we hide on social media. And so sometimes like I'll have a situation happen and I find an image that I've taken and match it together. I'm not instant with Instagram anymore. You guys remember that when it first came out and you had to like post it right away? People were like, same day, really restrictive about that. I was like, oh, it's not daytime. I can't post that like nighttime photo or whatever, you know? So I take my time. I don't post that much either. I post like maybe once or twice a week at the most. And I think that's changed a lot of things for me, is not caring about what social media is, you know, the way that it's toxic and tries to like push us to be like this version of ourselves that we're not. And it's almost like a diary now. And I'm chronicling my life in a way that is visual. And because that's also something that I need to do, it's like therapy for me. Like it gets it out, it gets it in the world. And I spend a lot of time sometimes going back to those captions and I reread them and I think about how I felt in that moment. And it relates to each other. So I think it's about being authentic and not overthinking it, if that answers your question.
Casey, I see that you have your hand raised. You want to unmute and ask your questions?
Okay, everybody, this is Casey who told me about the Instagram account. None of this would have happened if it wasn't for her. And we met at a volunteer thing at like making like cards and randomly met each other and started talking about life. And she's amazing. And so thank you for being here and being so amazing.
It's tough to meet friends as adults, like to meet people that you vibe with. But then to say, you know, there's a thing that's happening at a cemetery. Maybe you want to go to it. And Jay's like, yeah, sign me up. We're going.
So that's I'm there.
Ew, yes, exactly. You know, anyway, I'm so impressed. I'm floored, but also I know how incredible you are as a person. I just wanted to say I'm really happy this is happening. So anyway, and the California connection. I mean, we have all the connections, you know?
I know.
Yep. Yep.
Thank you, Casey. Appreciate you.
Yeah, Casey is great. I'll just find that. It's been so fun getting to know both of you. Okay, so there's another question in the chat that I think is really cool. And this is from John. And the question is, are there themes connected to death and or cemeteries that you have yet to shoot, but that you are interested in exploring?
Yeah, so I'm not sure if it's like cemeteries, but just end of life. As I sort of like delve more into this realm, this whole world that exists that nobody talks about ever until it's like the worst moment of your life or the life of a loved one or a friend. I'm thinking about, and I was a little hesitant to post like the pictures of my friend. I didn't even realize I was doing that, like taking pictures of us together. It was something I automatically did because I like didn't want to forget. And then I realized that I had this like series. And so one thing that I'm starting to think about is how do I show this part of life that is both parts heartbreaking, important, traumatic, private, but also bringing light and awareness to it at the same time in the most respectful way. And it's something that I feel very torn about. It's something that I also felt when I first walked into cemeteries. You know, I said that to you guys. I was like, is this even respectful? Like, where am I stepping? Where are my feet going? This is something I'm thinking about. I don't have any answers on like how that will sort of like come out into the world. I think that it's something that I could do, that it's important, but I want to make sure that it feels right. The part of why I would want to expose that experience, or if I learn more, is that I want other people to learn more and I want them to feel comfortable about talking about this with their friends and their family, because we're talking about these things when it's too late. And it's not something to be feared. Like, it's something that is actually respectful. Someone asked me recently if I knew where my parents wanted to be buried. I don't know. I don't know if my mom wants me to take her body back to Iran. That's a big question. And I don't want me or my siblings to be fighting about that in a time of despair, right? So the more we get more comfortable, and I'm thinking about how can I be a conduit for that, you know? And first I'm talking to people, the people that are comfortable. Not everybody is. I bring this stuff up. People are like, ooh, okay. Or they're like, are you a witch? I get that a lot too. No, those two things are not combined. So it's, I think I'm taking baby steps because it's a world that's new to me. But I also want to be careful and respectful. So that's something I'm thinking about. That's a really good question, John. Thank you for asking it. I'm going to continue to marinate in it.
Okay, we are right at 6:59. So there's one last question here. And Ashley asks, are there any books, documentaries, podcasts, etc. that you've loved and recommend on death and dying?
Oh my God, so many. Oh man, so many. I'm gonna have to think about those and maybe I'll post them in my stories. There is one book that I just read. My friend Adam, is Adam here? he gave it to me. I just read it. It's a memoir of this woman's experience with the grief of her father's death. It's a very short book. I read it literally in one night. It's not that short. I just couldn't put it down, but I'll recommend that book. It was beautiful. It was like memoirs of grief or something like that.
Jay, I'm here.
Oh, yeah. What was it called?
It's Notes on Grief.
Yes.
By Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie. I always mispronounce her name, but.
It's okay. It was so beautiful. And so beautiful that Adam was like, oh my God, you need to read this book. These gifts are coming to me from people the more I talk about these things. So right now I'm actually exploring just like a lot of like the technical parts of end of life because I want to understand, especially like with a friend going through that. But I'm reading more about people's experiences. I cried through that whole, I had to like stop a bunch of times. It was like devastating to hear that, but like you relate, right? You can like, it's human. It's okay. So I'll start to recommend more. Ashley, I think I know which one, who you are. you have a great book too. If it's the Ashley I'm thinking about on the end of life as well. So thank you for that. I'll definitely like keep that in mind as I come across stuff to share it more. And we're a minute over, I'm sorry.
No, I'm so glad that we... That's great. Thank you all for sticking around. Not sticking around, we're a minute over. Thank you all for being right on time. Excellent work. Good job. Excellent planning. A+ to everyone. No. Jay, I just want to say thank you once again on behalf of North Burial Ground and